216 in your hymnal, 216, dwelling in Beulah Lane. Let's all stand together as we sing, far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. 216 on that first together. Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the sins of earth beset on every hand. Doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered here, protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining, here the night can harm me. I am safe forever
in Beulah Land.
I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. I see the way he planned. Dwelling in the Spirit, here I learn a full salvation. Gladly will I tarry in Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah Land.
Amen. Great singing tonight. Good to see you back in church. Hope you had a good afternoon. Looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. Thanks for being back in church on Sunday evening. Let's open with prayer together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer tonight. We thank you, Lord, for good morning this morning and for decisions that were made for you. And Lord, thank you for the good service they had at the nursing home this afternoon, and for the those who labor there, Lord, week after week, and their labor of love for those folks. And I pray your blessing upon them. And Lord, we thank you for the good organizational meeting we had at 5:45, and for people willing to serve and willing to help and desiring to impact our community for Christ. And I pray, God, that now you'll meet with us during this service as well. We bow before you. We ask you to help us. We ask you to speak to us tonight. Give us what we need from your word. Bless the music and our fellowship together. Make this service exactly what you desire it to be in our lives. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
334 in your hymnal, 334, still sweeter every day. To Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. Let's sing that verse together. To Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. He's fairer than the glory of the golden purple dawn. He's all my fancy pictures in his fairest dreams and more. Each day he grows still sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancied this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be so sweeter than he ever was before. His glory broke upon me before. The half cannot be fancied, this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be still sweeter than he ever was before. My heart is sometimes heavy, but he comes with sweet relief. He folds me to his bosom when I droop with blight and grief. I love the Christ who all my burdens in his body bore. Each day he grows still sweeter than he was the day before. Love cannot be fancied, this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be still sweeter than he ever was before.
All right, some announcements now. Remember, we begin Operation Saturation, all right? So everybody get some flyers, sign them out, get some reservation cards, and let's go after it, all right? There's no wrong door you can knock on. There's no wrong person you can give it to. It'd be great if somebody got one when went to the store, and they got one when somebody knocked on their door, and they had one on their car at work, and they had one everywhere they go. They see a flyer for Thanksgiving dinner, and that's great. Share it with you. Share it on social media. Get the word out and invite folks to come and be your guest on November 13th. That's every day this week. Just stay after it. The doors will be open. Just come and reload when you get empty, and let's keep at it all week long. All right. Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we'll have our missionary to the military, Harold Pierce, with the Armed Forces Baptist Missions, and he'll be here presenting, kind of updating us on what the Lord's been doing there with our chaplains and such in the Armed Forces. And so that'll be a good time together Wednesday night with our missionary Harold Pierce and his family. Then remember, next Saturday night to fall back an hour, all right? And let's see, what happens if you don't? Then you're going to come, you're going to think you're come for Sunday school, and it's going to be church, right? Is that how that works? It'll be 8:30. Oh, you'll come at 9:30 for Sunday school, but it'll really be 8:30. Hey, you know what? If you don't fall back, you'll come for what you think is church, and you'll get here for Sunday school. How about that? Some of you non-Sunday school people, you ought to try that. You know, maybe that'll work, all right? But fall back next. You get an extra hour of sleep. How great is that? And so we'll look forward to that, and that'll be a great time. Okay? All right. I think that's all I'm going to go over right now. Let's take just a moment. We'll welcome any guests we have with us in the service. Always pleased when folks visit with us, especially on a Sunday night. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Right here. Got a couple guys right here. This fella in the sweatshirt here is Alan Walters, and Brother Alan's here for the very first time, and good to have Alan with us, and thank you for being here, my friend. And who's this young man right here? Andrew Burton. Andrew, where are you from? Right here in Columbus. Okay. Is that right? Wow, build us up pretty big, huh? All right. I hope we can live up to that, all right? Who's your neighbor? Oh, BJ. All right, so here she is. She invited you to come, and she didn't come tonight. That's usually how it works, you know, man? And, hey, great to have you this evening. Thank you for being here. That's great. Wonderful. If you guys will take just a minute and fill the card out, we would appreciate you doing that. And a little bit, we have an offering, and just drop that card in the plate as it goes by, and we'll have a record of your visit with us tonight. You go ahead and hang on to that pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. We're glad you're here. Let's give these young men a warm welcome, shall we?
There's no foundation stable, and there's no rock I know that's able. I know that's able.
right, would you turn with me to number 11? Number 11, long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is mine. Number 11 on that first altogether. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged a sinner for a sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. He is mine. He is mine. Blessed beyond all measure, he is mine. I have pardon full and free through the blood he shed for me. Tonight? Amen. Amen. Let's go over to 91. 91. What a day. What a glorious day that will be. Would you stand with me as we sing? There's coming a day when no heartache shall come. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. As you find your seats, let's sing that last together. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear. And when we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. Sing that with your whole heart, that a cappella. All right, on that last together. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be
with the one
who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Everybody say it. Amen. Be seated if you will. Great singing tonight. Getting hard up for ushers, huh? And enlisted Brother Moreland to take the offering tonight. Amen. It's always good to have the Morelands with us. And they'll be, when you heading out to go south? Probably tonight, right? After that comment, yeah. When are you going to go? About a week and a half, all right? So they'll continue to pray for them. They still have a target date, I think, of about next March or so. End of March, April. April 11th, okay. April 11th, they'll be leaving for Armenia. So won't be too much longer. And continue to pray for more support to come in for them. And then the passage, you know, they got to get tickets and get everything over there. You think about, now, how many of you moved before in your life? Huh? You could at least pack everything up in a truck or, you know, and drive it somewhere. Try going across the ocean and to a whole other country and decide what do you take, what do you leave, where you got to start over. It's a big process. And so be praying for the Morelands and pray for God to take care of their every need. Amen. I'm going to have Ron lead us in our prayer tonight for our offering. Brother Moreland.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for a chance that we can come before you this evening and come into your house and just worship you and praise your name. Lord, I ask that you'll be with the preacher today as he preaches your word and speak to our hearts. Lord, I also ask that you'll bless this offering, bless this time of fellowship. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, Lisa. Take your Bible this evening, if you would. Joshua chapter 6, please. Joshua chapter 6. Sure enjoy Sunday night church. Look forward to it. Joshua chapter 6. We're going to read the first five verses of Joshua chapter 6, and we'll read them responsively as we normally do. Begin together on one, and I'll read two. We'll alternate till we end together on verse 5 of Joshua chapter 6. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 1 of Joshua chapter 6. Ready? Now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, and none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, See, I have given into thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shalt thou do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns, and the 7th day ye shall compass the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when ye hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat. And the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing now this evening, Lord, to the reading of your word. We want to thank you tonight for the Bible. And Lord, thank you already for the wonderful music that we've enjoyed tonight. Sure is good to sing to you and to hear the people of God sing your praises. Father, we're asking now that you would open our hearts, open our understanding as we come to your word. And I pray, Lord, that you would give us all ears to hear what you would say to your church this evening. And Father, I pray your blessing on the special as it's sung now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Shadows are falling, time marches on, prophets are echoing, soon Christ will come. Looking into the heart of man, seeking his own, calling all of the faithful, children come home. Listen for the trumpet, Jesus is coming. Listen for the trumpet, look to the sky. No more sorrow, no more night, only God's eternal light. Jesus is coming again. Come, Lord, in majesty, from heaven's throne, shout for your saints to rise. Lord, take us home. Call us out of this world of sin. Come, Lord, today. Quickly, Jesus, come quickly. Take us away. Listen for the trumpet. Jesus is coming. Listen for the trumpet. Look to the sky. No more sorrow, no more pain, only God's eternal light. Jesus is coming again. No more sorrow, no more night, only God's eternal light. Jesus is coming again.
That's good. Father, we bow before you in prayer now. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful promise that you certainly are coming again. And Lord, we know that it could be this evening that we'll see you. We'll hear the trumpet sound. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Father, we hold that as our blessed hope. Lord, we are excited, and we believe, and we would love for you to come this evening. Lord, I understand if you tarry your coming, that you would help us to stay busy about the Father's business, that we would occupy until you come. And Lord, tonight I pray you'd open our understanding and help us as we look at these Old Testament passages in the book of Joshua. We would glean from them what you would have to help us as we look at these next 2 weeks at once again endeavoring to capture our city for Christ. And so, Lord, help me as I bring the truth this evening, and please help each individual as they listen. Stir our hearts as only you can stir our hearts tonight. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Canaan, as most of you know, is the children of Israel now have crossed Jordan and they've gone into the land of Canaan. I know there's some songs that have been written about, you know, on Jordan's stormy banks, I stand and cast a wistful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land where my possessions lie. And there, that song kind of represents Canaan as heaven, but that's a nice song, but it's not true to the Bible. The Canaan is not heaven. You notice when they got into Canaan, they had some enemies there. They had some battles to fight in Canaan. I got news for you. When you get to heaven, the battles are over. When you get to heaven, there's nobody to drive out. But the Canaan is a picture of a victorious Christian life. That's why Moses could not lead the children of Israel into the promised land. Moses represented the law. Nobody's going to get victory by living by the law. You're going to get victory by living by Christ. So who led them in? Joshua. Joshua is the Old Testament. For the New Testament, if you put that Joshua into Greek, it's Jesus. He is the one who will lead them to victory. And Jesus is the one who leads us to victory. The victory, as we've been learning on Wednesday nights in the spiritual warfare, the victory comes by being strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. It comes by His power, not our power. It comes by Jesus' might, nor by our might. It comes because He got the victory, we get the victory. Because He was victorious over sin, we live victorious over sin. Because He conquered sin and death, we conquer sin and death. We get the victory because He's done the victory. And when we understand that. So we learn as they come into the land of Canaan, the promised land as you were, and by the way, that was God's goal for them. God's goal for them was to be in victory. God's goal for them was to possess the land that He wanted them to have. In other words, live in victory, drive out the enemy, and possess all that God wanted them to have. And that is exactly what God wants for you and me tonight. He wants us to possess all that He desires for us to have in our life. He desires for us to be victorious over the enemies. Every one of us have battles. There's not a single Christian here tonight that doesn't fight battles. Everybody's in spiritual warfare. Everybody's in hand-to-hand combat with the forces of evil. Now, I believe that the battles they faced as they went into Canaan are battles we'll face in our Christian life. I believe the enemies that they faced as they went into Canaan, our enemies will face in our Christian life. I believe that these things were written for our learning. These things were written for us to get something from it. And so I don't think God just recorded it to record some history for Israel. It's good, it's fine, it is historical, but I think it's application for us. We learn from their attacks. I think their plan of attack to defeat the enemy would be our plan of attack to defeat the enemy. I think their strategy to defeat the enemy would be our strategy to defeat the enemy. And I want us tonight to look at three battles we're going to focus on and how God gave them the victory and God gave them, He had them win each one of these three battles. And we're going to face the same foes and we can get the same victories. Let's look at them tonight. Joshua chapter 6, of course, is a very familiar one to us, and that is the Battle of Jericho. We just read this evening the first five verses, and most of you are very familiar with this. If you've been in church or Sunday school, you've heard the story of the Battle of Jericho and since you were a little kid. And you understand what happened, and the walls came down, and God gave them the victory. But on Jericho, we learn this lesson. Follow God's plan. Follow God's plan. When they came to Jericho, they sought God, and God gave them the plan. What was the plan? Once a day, you're going to walk all the way around the city. Okay? The priests, the Levites, the people, everybody, they're going to march one time around the city, and then they were going to go back to their camp. And what would they do on the second day? Come out and do it again. March around the city. And by the way, when they march around the city, nobody was to say a word. Now, on the seventh day when the walls came down, that was miraculous. But I think it was pretty miraculous that for 6 days they walked around that city and nobody said a word. That may be just as big of a miracle, I don't know. But they walked around and everybody was quiet. Nobody said a word. And they did exactly what God told them to do. I do want you to notice what the scripture says here. Verse 1, Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. That city was shut up. They were in lockdown. That's what cities would do when an army would come surround them. But in Jericho was a fortress. They just closed up the gates and shut everything off, and they just would outwait the enemy until the enemy would decide to leave and maybe go find an easier target. Okay? But I got news for you. It doesn't matter what city is shut up, God has a way to open the city. I understand, and listen, I believe with all my heart, when the Bible talks about our spiritual warfare, remember we talked about principalities and powers and rulers of darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. Principalities. A prince is someone who's over a territory. The Prince of Wales, that's his territory. It's interesting. When the demons who were possessed of that demoniac in Mark chapter 5, if you recall, they asked Jesus that they wouldn't have to depart out of that country. I believe that was their principality. I believe they wanted to stay in that principality. We can't see it because we don't have those spiritual eyes to see the spiritual warfare and the spiritual beings that are going on. But there's principalities over Columbus, Ohio. There's principalities over Grove City, Ohio. There's principalities over Groveport, Ohio. There's principalities over Hilliard, Ohio. There's principalities over Urban Crest. And there's principalities over Orient. There's principalities over these areas. And sometimes it feels like, man, they're just shut up to the things of God. But I got news for you. God has a way of opening those things up. And no matter what man closes, God can open. And God's going to show them. He's going to open Jericho up to them. The plan would be that they'd march around and one time a day for 6 days, then seven times on the seventh day. Then the priest would blow on their ram's horn, a long blow. And when they heard the sound of the horn, everybody would shout with a great shout, and those massive walls that would be somewhere 12 to 18 feet thick, the Bible says they'll fall down flat. And everybody can go straight into the city. How many understand if you had a wall that thick and it just fell down, you wouldn't go straight into anything except a pile of rubble and brick and stone. But you know what he did? He had to come down flat. That was miraculous. Unbelievable. And of course, you know the story. They went in and conquered the city. But listen, their strategy, their plan is our plan. What's our plan? Encompass the city. That's the operation saturation. That's what that's all about. That's why we go through our area I was thinking just about every year between the tracts that are given out on a regular basis and the big days that we have, we'll do somewhere between 50 and 60,000 tracts every year. I mean, 56,000 pieces of literature with the gospel on them will go out from this church every single year. Now you think about that over 10 years, that's over 500,000 pieces of the gospel that have gone out into somebody's hands or somebody's house around the greater Columbus area. That's trying to encompass our city with the gospel. That's why we see victories. That's why, and by the way, that's why I expect another victory on November 13th. I expect God to do another great thing on the 13th of November. And I noticed they all marched around Jericho. Nobody was exempted. Nobody sat this one out. Nobody said, well, I think it's okay if these others march. My marching days are over. You don't read of anybody saying that. Don't read of anybody doing that. They all were to do as Joshua commanded them to do. Who's Joshua representing? Jesus Christ. Each of us do what Jesus Christ has commanded us to do and follow His plan. And by the way, the plan that Jesus gave is that each of us are to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I think it's good to knock on doors. I think it's good to put flyers in a door. But listen, I'll tell you what's better. Give one to every person, you see. Go to every creature. Instead of, it's go door to door soul winning. That's great. Why don't you try person to person soul winning sometime? I mean, every person you see, go talk to them and tell them about Christ or try endeavor to give the gospel to them. That is God's plan. God said, who's going to go? We're going to go. He said, listen, it's amazing, isn't it? When Christ was born, who announced His birth? The angels did. When He was on the cross and dying, He says, don't you know I could right now call 12 legions of angels and they'd come rescue me? Angels were standing by waiting. When He arose from the dead, who was there to announce His resurrection? The angels were. When He ascended back to heaven, two angels stood by Him in white apparel and said, you men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner have you seen Him go into heaven. Angels announced His ascension. The Bible says He'll come back with His holy angels. And so I think when it came time for God to say, all right, now we're going to get a plan to get the gospel, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Christ to the whole world, I think the angel says, all right, man, give us the orders. We're ready to go. We're ready to tell it. And God says, no, you stand down. We're going to give it to these guys. I wonder if the angels went, ay, 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 ay. Huh? You think the angel said, you're going to give it to them? But God said, yeah, hey, who better to tell it than those who've experienced it? Who better to tell of the Savior than those who've received the Savior? Who better to tell others of sins forgiven than those who's had their sins forgiven? Who better to tell others of eternal life than those who've received eternal life? Oh my, that's the plan. We have to follow God's plan. You know, the other thing I notice here about their plan is nobody shouted until they did everything they were commanded to do. Nobody said a word till they completed that seventh time on the seventh day. And they heard the ram's horns blow and then they shouted. Can I help apply that to our situation? If you're not going to pass out any flyers for the big day, be quiet. Don't say a word. Don't you go criticizing somebody who is. Don't you go criticizing what else is going on. If you don't invite others to Christ, you don't invite others to come to church, then you just be quiet. If you never give out a gospel tract to anybody, you just be quiet. You just hush. Hush. I won't say shut up because you don't say that word, right? Once you follow God's blueprint, once you follow God's plan, and you see God do some amazing things. You see God save souls. You see lives changed. You see people reach with the gospel. Then it'll be time to shout. Then it'll be time to rejoice. Then it'll be time to say glory to God. Oh, it was great today. Got that text from Sue Burns. Sue Burns' father has had cancer. And we've been praying. They are unsure of his salvation and didn't think he was saved. And they'd been witnessing to him. And I think she has a brother who's a minister. And he's been talking to him. And she just sent out a text today rejoicing that her dad put his faith in Jesus Christ as his Savior. And publicly told him about it and desires to be baptized. And God saved his soul. Hey, now they're shouting. Now there's rejoicing. That's the way it works. Amen. You know, Another thing I see here, by following God's plan, listen, it took faith to do what they did. You think about that? Can you imagine? It is always amazing. I think about with the Gideon caper when he was going against the Midianites. And remember, God whittled them down to 300 guys. And I'm sure the 300 guys thought, well, that's okay. We're going to have some powerful weapons here, man. We're going to have some great explosives, or we're going to have a great, we're going to have some great bombers here. They're going to come in. And they found out, no, you get a lamp and a pitcher, and, you just break that at the appropriate time. And then yell real loud. Imagine these people marching around. By the way, marching around, once they not saying anything. Let me ask you a question. Remember where Rahab lived? She lived on the wall. People lived on that wall. Do you think they watched them march around there once a day? Do you think anybody made fun of them? You better believe they did. I'm sure they mocked them. And listen, but nobody said a word. They just kept doing what God told them to do. That took faith, my friend. Once a day, go back home. Next 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 day, go 7 times. And then you hear the trumpet and everybody shouts and the walls came tumbling down. Wow. Their faith was rewarded. Their faith was rewarded. They didn't doubt. They acted on their faith. Faith to believe that God would do what he said he would do. Say, well, go out and give out flyers or go out and try to get people saved. Man, I don't know if I can do that. Listen, just do what God told you to do. God does the saving. God will do his part. You do your part. That's all he asks. The victory is not in our power, but in God's power. Do you think any of those Israelites could say, it was my yelling that knocked that wall down? Huh? Any of them could brag about that? No, that was God. God had to. Every one of them had to say, wow, look at that. That wall fell down and look, it's flat. We can go right in and start killing everybody. God gave us this city. Follow God's plan. Well, they took care of Jericho and they came to the next battle. Look at Joshua chapter 7. Joshua chapter 7. Verse number 2 says, Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth-Aven on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai. Make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. So there went up thither the people, about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote of them about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate even unto Shibarim, and smote them in the going down, wherefore the hearts of the people melted and became as water. Now they came to little, it's a little name, 2 letters, Ai, and it's a little city. And they made the mistake of thinking it was a little battle. Where Jericho is, follow God's plan. The lesson from Ai is simply this. There are no small battles. There are no small battles. Did you notice? Make not all the people go up. They lost 36 men in that battle. 36 wives didn't have a husband come home that night. 36 children that started that day with a daddy went to bed that night without a daddy. Because they thought, this is just a little battle. No big deal. You see, it takes everybody doing God's plan. It takes everybody getting into the fight. It takes everybody willing to fight. There's always a temptation, especially as we go into now the 11th time we've done a turkey dinner Sunday. There's always temptation, well, you know what? They always get the flyers out. They always get it done. They can get her done without me this time. And somebody wants to sit out. My friend, don't sit out. Everybody. It takes everybody in the battle. There's no, if it just one, in this case, by the way, what happened? We know what happened, don't we? One person held back. What was his name? Achan. You find out over in Jericho when God said you're to destroy everything. He said, now the silver and the gold and those things, that's to be brought into the Lord's house. That was all for God. And Achan saw it and said, I could use a little bit more in my retirement account. I could use a new suit of clothes. And he took it and he hid that stuff under his tent. And there was sin in the camp. Somebody had disobeyed God. And he caused the whole thing to come to a halt. Unbelievable. It hurt everybody. One person's hidden sin hurt everyone. That's a frightening thing. So listen, don't be that guy. Don't be that Achan. Make sure you keep it confessed. Make sure that you have things clear between you and God. Don't be an Achan. Everybody has to battle. Everybody has to obey God. Everybody has to participate. Everybody has to follow God's plan. Everybody ought to want to knock on doors. Everybody ought to get a flyer out. Everybody ought to pray. Everybody ought to invite. Everybody ought to visit. Everybody ought to be willing to serve. Everybody ought to be wanting to encourage somebody else. If not, we'll get an AI. We'll get an AI. Well, they dealt with the sin with Achan. God showed them what it was. And by the way, when you read the end of chapter 7, they stoned him with stones and then burned him with fire after they stoned him with stones. Now let's go to chapter 8. Now the Lord said to Joshua, fear not, neither be thou dismayed. Take all the people of war with thee. Arise, go up to Ai. By the way, take how many of the people of war? Huh, all. Huh. Different plan now, huh? I have given into thy hand the king of Ai and his people and his city and his land. Thou shalt do to Ai and her king as thou didst unto Jericho and her king. Only the spoil thereof and the cattle thereof shall ye take for a prey unto yourselves. And then he gives a strategy about laying an ambush for the city behind it. And of course, they followed that plan, and God gave them a great victory. They slayed all the men of Ahab, or all the men of Ai. And they got the victory by God's instructions. But listen, all of them had to go. Everybody had to fight. Everybody had to follow God's plan. And everybody, they learned no battle is a small battle. Don't overlook. It can be the little foxes that spoil the vine. Don't overlook that. So we find from Jericho, what's the lesson from Jericho? Follow God's plan. What's the lesson we learned from Ai? No battle is a small battle. There's one more battle they faced, the next one. Joshua chapter 10. Joshua chapter 10. In Joshua 10, we have five kings and their nations attacking the Gibeonites. Now, don't have time to go into it here, but look this way for a minute. In chapter 9, the Gibeonites hear of all these people that are being destroyed by the Israelites, and they don't want to be one of them, okay? And so they come up with a plan, and their plan was, we're going to put on old clothes, we're going to get some moldy bread, and we're going to act like we've come from a long way off. But we're not part of this land at all. We're going to get them to make peace with us. Okay? And so they did that. They dressed in their old clothes and got torn clothing and such and old stuff, and they got moldy bread. And they came and they fooled the children of Israel. They fooled Joshua and the people. And they made a league with him that, okay, we won't do you any harm. We'll keep you safe. Well, as time went by, it became known that these are the Gibeonites. They live here. They haven't come from a long way off. They were lying to us. Ah, but wait a minute. In fact, just briefly look at chapter 9. The congregation is murmuring. Verse 18 says, "The children of Israel smote them not." That's the Gibeonites. "Because the princes of the congregation had sworn unto them by the Lord God of Israel." Now all the congregation murmured against the princes. They were upset with the leaders. But the leaders said, "Hey, we promised we wouldn't harm them. And we're going to keep our word." Even though they did under false pretenses. But all the princes of the congregation said unto all the congregation, verse 19, "We have sworn unto them by the Lord God of Israel. Now therefore we may not touch them." So he says, they're going to be servants. We're going to make them, verse 21, hewers of wood and drawers of water unto all the congregation. But they're going to not die. We're going to protect them. Well, go into chapter 10, and you find out that it came to pass, Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, had heard how Joshua had taken Ai and utterly destroyed it, as he had done to Jericho and her king. So he had done to Ai and her king, and how the inhabitants of Gibeon had made peace with Israel that were among them, and were among them. And they feared greatly because Gibeon was a great city, as one of the royal cities, and because it was greater than Ai, and all the men thereof were mighty. Wherefore, here's the kings. There's five kings here. Adonai Zedek, the king of Jerusalem, and Hoem, the king of Hebron, and Piram, the king of Jarmuth, and Japhia, the king of Lachish, and Debir, the king of Eglon. These five guys say, "Come up with me and help me that we may smite Gibeon, for it hath made peace with Joshua and with the children of Israel." Therefore, these five kings that it mentions again, they gathered themselves together and went up, and they and all their host, and they encamped before Gibeon and made war against it. Well, what did the men of Gibeon do? They sent to Joshua. Verse 6, "Slack not thy hand from thy servants. Come up to us quickly and save us and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites that dwell in the mountains are gathered together against us." Boy, they send out the SOS to Joshua. "Man, you got to help us here. You said you'd protect us and you would take care of us. Now we need your help." I want you to notice what Joshua did. Joshua ascended from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said unto Joshua, "Fear them not, for I have delivered them into thine hand, and there shall not a man of them stand before thee." Joshua therefore came upon them suddenly and went up from Gilgal. Last two words. All night. All night. And what happened? The Lord discomfited them before Israel and slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon, and chased them along the way that goeth up to Beth Horon, and smote them to Azekah and unto Makeda. And it came to pass as they fled from Israel and were in going down to Beth Horon that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them unto Azekah, and they died. And there were more which died with hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. How about that? I like as these kings, or the Gibeonites, come under attack from the kings, that God intervenes for Joshua, and he casts great stones down from heaven, hailstones or stones, and more were killed by the stones than what were killed by the armies of Israel. I don't know about you, but if I'd have been in the army that night, I'd have said, "Wow, this is amazing. Look at this." And that would have been incredible enough, but wait, God wasn't done yet. He still had more to do. Look at verse 12. "Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites for the children of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies, Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. Now listen to this. There was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. And Joshua returned and all Israel with him unto the camp to Gilgal. For the Lord fought for Israel. Now, God did, there's no doubt about it, God did some extraordinary things there. Do you understand what it takes? You understand, I don't, does anybody real scientific in here tonight? How fast are we going around right now? How fast? Approximately. I won't hold you to it. About 66,000 miles an hour. Do you realize if God just stopped us right now, we'd all be spots on the wall? It'd be over. That's why people look at this and say, you can't do that. Hey, God made it. God can do anything He wants. God wants to stop, and He did. He stopped the sun, the moon. He stopped the whole rotation of everything. He just stopped it so they could continue to fight the battle. And when that's unbelievable. In fact, God said, you know what? He never did it before, and He's never done it since. This is an amazing, a miraculous thing. Unbelievable. Why did God do that? Why did God send the hailstones? Why did God stop the sun and the moon and stop the rotation of the earth so that they could win a battle? I'm going to tell you why. They did something unusual. So God responded with something unusual. You remember when they went up to help Gibeah? They got word that they needed help, and Joshua said, fellas, mighty men, come here. All the army guys, come here. We're leaving first thing in the morning. Is that what he said? No. When are we leaving? Right now. Wait a minute, we're going all night? Yeah, going all night. And they went all night to get there and then set the battle array in the morning. And God saw them do something unusual. And God said, you know what? I think I'll do something unusual. God responds to our faith. You know, we all want God to do the extraordinary, but we don't want to do anything out of the ordinary. Oh, we want God to send a revival, but do it before noon on Sunday because, you know, I do want to get to the restaurant. Well, yeah, God, I want a revival, but Lord, you know, we don't want to have a five-night revival. That's just too much in these days. Yeah, God, I want a revival. God, I want you to save souls, but Lord, I'm only going to pass out flyers one day a week. You see, we went, God, you do something unusual. God, you do something out of the ordinary, but I'm not going to break my routine at all. I just like it the way I've got it. But if we want God to do something unusual, we need to do something unusual. God responds to what we do. The Bible says, God says, you draw nigh to me, and I will draw nigh to you. You have not because you ask not. I believe we serve a miracle-working God. We still do. God hasn't changed. He'll still respond to what we do. We need some people who will say, somebody who will say, we need several somebody who say, I'll go over and above for 13 days. I'll go over and above to do something unusual, to do something out of my ordinary. Inviting people or praying more and fasting and skipping some meals or having an all-night prayer meeting, doing something. I'm going to do something unusual in these next 2 weeks, asking God to do something unusual for us. That I might see God do the miraculous. We were talking the other day, Brother Wallace, about Elisha and Elijah. How when Elijah knew that he was going to be taken to heaven, and Elisha wanted to stay close to him. Elisha had asked for a double portion of his spirit to be on him. Whatever Elijah had, Elisha wanted it. And while other preacher boys, if you will, prophets, they were content to follow from a distance, Elisha would stick with them. You read about it in 2 Kings there when Elijah go to one place and he say, okay, now you stay here, I'm going on to this place. Elijah says, no, you're going there, I'm going there. I'm not staying here. And wherever he went, his shadow followed him. That was Elisha. And then finally Elijah said, okay, if you see me when I'm taken up to heaven, then you'll get your request. And of course they came to the Jordan River, and Elijah took off his cloak and he smote the Jordan River, and the river parted. And they began to cross the Jordan River, and of course that's when he said that the horsemen of Israel and the chariot thereof, and here they came. And they came and took Elijah to heaven in a whirlwind. And Elisha saw it. You know what he did when he went and came back to that Jordan? He picked up that coat of Elijah and he smote those waters of Jordan. You remember what he said? Where is the Lord God of Elijah? Hey, everything I saw Elijah do and everything I saw you do for Elijah, God, I want to see you do that for me. And guess what? He smote those waters and the waters parted. And by the way, Elisha did get a double portion of Elisha's spirit. There were 8 recorded miracles that Elijah did, and there's 16 that Elisha did. He got a double portion. He saw the Lord God of Elijah. I believe this. I believe if we follow God's plan, if we have everyone participate, I believe we'll see God do the miraculous. That's what the 5 Kings teach us. God can do the miraculous. God's still in the miracle working business. God hasn't changed. Let's not shortchange God. I want to see the Lord God of Elijah at work. I want to see the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. I want to see the God that parted the Red Sea. I want to see the God that provided the manna for 2 or 3 million Jews every morning. I want to see God that provided water. You know, I think there's just under 2 million in the greater Columbus area. Can you imagine providing water for that many people every single day? Don't think when that water come out of the rock, it was a little trickle coming down on the rock. You kidding me? That stuff was gushing out. Because it's not only for the people, but all their cattle and all their animals. Brother Manning last night was telling us how he had spent 4 hours that morning pumping water from the creek and taking it down to the cattle. He said the average cow there, 20 gallons of water a day. Think about that. That's the God I want to see, who can provide water for that many people from a rock. I want to see the God who delivered Daniel from the lion's den and the God who delivered the 3 Hebrew young men from the fiery furnace. Wouldn't it be great for a church like Bible Baptist Church to say, hey, we want to see the Lord God of Elijah. We want to see God do the miraculous. But let's do our part. Let's follow God's plan. Let's everyone participate. And let's ask God and expect God to do the miraculous in our midst. Let's pray together. Shall we, Father, help us this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the Word of God and these lessons we glean from these folks going into the Promised Land. How they captured these cities. And Lord, we desire to capture our city for Christ. You've placed us here in this area. We want to impact our area with the gospel. And God, I pray you'd help us to follow the blueprint for victory that you gave to the children of Israel as they went into the land of Canaan. Tonight, God, I pray you've spoken to people's hearts. And there'll be every member of Bible Baptist Church would say, I will follow the instructions. I'll follow the plan that's been given through the leadership to capture our city. There'll be no small battles. Everyone must participate. No one can sit back and say, just let a few people do it. We'll experience AI if we do. I pray that no one is an Achan. That if anyone has that sin in their life that could hinder the work of God in this place, that they would be on their knees tonight confessing and forsaking it. And when we confess and forsake, you've promised to have mercy. And then, Lord, I pray that as you did with these five kings, we would do something out of our ordinary, that you would respond and do something out of the ordinary for us. Lord, I'd love to see some things happen on November 13th and between now and November 13th, that there'd be no way to explain it except God. Please, hear our prayer tonight. Show us the Lord God of Elijah. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. We'll have our invitation. I wonder how many folks here this evening. They say, preacher, the Spirit of God has spoken to my heart. By His grace, I'll follow the plan, His plan. I will participate. And I will ask and expect God to do the miraculous in my life and in our church life over the next 2 weeks. Pastor, the Spirit of God has spoken to my heart tonight. Here's my hand this evening. Will you slip it up? Will you slip it up, Christian? Amen. Amen. That's great. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has dealt with your heart. The way we win the victory is on our knees. The Lord must fight for us. The Lord must do the work. We're going to labor. We're going to pass out the flyers. God can turn their heart, cause them to come. We do that by prayer. Some of you physically aren't going to be able to get out and pass out a lot of flyers. You physically can't do the walking anymore. But you sure can do the praying. Spend that time in prayer. Show God you'll do something out of the ordinary with prayer. Whatever it is the Lord's revealed to you that He wants you to do, follow His instructions. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts. I pray your will be done now in each one of our lives. Hear our prayers. We bow our knee to you tonight. God, do something special for us on November 13th, 2016. Please, Lord, hear our prayer tonight. I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart tonight. Respond to Him, will you please?
Oh, to Jesus surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly at His feet. I bow, worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender. Fill me with Thy love and power. I surrender all.
Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for a wonderful day today in the house of God. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this place. Thank you for what you're doing in the lives of people who are yielded to you. I pray, God, that you'd use us this week now as we go out from this place and we go to give the gospel to every creature. Go before us as you went before Paul and Silas as they went into Philippi. You opened the heart of Lydia that she attended unto the things that Paul said to her. Open the hearts of people that we'll talk to. Open the hearts of people that will receive a flyer, that they want to receive Christ, that they would want to be here on that day. Lord, we pray for a great, great harvest of souls on November 13th. Lord, please strengthen us. Please help us. Please help us to rely upon you to do a mighty work in us and through us. We love you. We thank you for a good day in the house of the Lord. Dismiss us now with your blessing and make us mindful you go with us from this place. It's in Jesus' name we do ask it. Amen. Amen. We do need help. Tomorrow after the graveside service for Brother Messer's sister, we're having a meal for the family back here at the church. And we need some tables set up over there and chairs and such. Tanya will be there to let you know how she wants those arranged. Nine tables and chairs. We got some fellows who would take care of that. Anybody would come jump over there and take care of that? You guys? Okay. Thank you. Is Tanya over there now? Where is she? She's right there. Okay. You get a head start, Tanya. Go ahead if you would. You can slip over there so you can give them instructions how you want it set up. All right. Well, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it together. All right. Let's hear you sing. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed.